Hello, everybody. This is Olivia, and I'm here today to teach you about the Hobby Lobby v. Burwell case, or the Burwell v. Hobby Lobby case. And this presentation was done by me and Ruby, so let's get into it. So now I'm going to talk to you about some introductory and background information regarding our case. So first is the Patient Protection and Affordable Care Act. This law is often referred to or stylized as the ACA or Obamacare. It was signed into law by, obviously, our 44th president, Barack Obama, and was signed on in the March 23rd of 2010 after struggling through both the House of Representatives and the Senate. The goal of this statute is to expand coverage, hold insurance companies accountable, lower healthcare costs, and give more choice in the healthcare market, with varying levels of success over the last, I think, 7 years. Our current president is attempt our current president, Senate, and House of Reps are currently attempting to repeal and or replace the statute. The replace part is a little fuzzy depending on who you talk to. The second law regarding our case is the Religious Freedom Restoration Act. This act was set into motion after two cases, Sherbert v. Verner and Wisconsin v. Yoder, were unsure whether the First Amendment, which guarantees freedom of speech, had been violated. Unlike the previous law, the statute passed unanimously in the House of Representatives and almost unanimously, unanimously in the Senate. This law is meant to keep the federal government from infringing on religious rights unless, this is a quote directly from the writ of cert, one is in furtherance of compelling governmental interest, and two is in the least restrictive means of furthering that compelling governmental interest. And that, like I said before, was taken directly from the writ of cert from the Hobby Lobby case. So each of these connect to the Burwell v. Hobby Lobby case in sort of similar ways. The ACA connects with our case through the Health Resources and Services Administration, or the HRSA, because that is a very long title. This branch of the U.S. Department of Health and Human Resources decides both which preventative health cares, so birth control or contraceptives, would be provided by employers, and which employers would be exempt from providing certain health cares based on their religion or stuff like that. Within the law, people exempt from providing contraceptives are religious employers, so churches, association of churches, and any religious order, nonprofits that object to contraceptives, employers providing plans that haven't changed since March 23rd, 2010, when this law was signed into law, and it has some name like the grandfather plan, I can't remember exactly, and employers with fewer than 50 employees, so all of those people are exempt. This ties the Religious Freedom Restoration Act, which says that the government can infringe our religious rights, and for some religions, contraceptives are a very big no-no. So that's just some of the background info on our case. Let's get into it. So this is kind of an overview of the case, and what exactly happened and what the ruling was. So Hobby Lobby is a family-owned chain of arts and craft stores based in Oklahoma. They are one of the largest privately owned corporations with around 21,000 employees and are owned by David Green, a self-made billionaire and devout evangelical Christian. And they are very, very centered around their Christian values. So September 2012, the Green family dropped their health care that they're supposed to provide, which provided Plan B and Ella, both contraceptives, and sued Kathy Sebelius, the former Secretary of Health and Human Services, which the HRSA is a part of. The lawsuit was then passed over to Sylvia Burwell, the current Secretary of Health and Human Services, which is where the V. Burwell comes from. They argued that the requirement to provide a form of contraceptive violated their First Amendment rights and the RFRA, or the Religious Freedom Restoration Act. They had no objections to 16 of the 20 drugs required to be provided, except for four contraceptives, as they claimed they were life-terminating, the other two being Paragard and Mirena and Skyla, which were both IUDs. This is a very long and complicated case. It lasted from September 2012 to June of 2014, so I'm just gonna cut it short. The Supreme Court finally met with the defendants and the prosecution on March 25th of 2014, after spending 2 years in the lower courts trying to get up to the Supreme Court. 3 months later, the court rules in favor of Hobby Lobby, deciding that they are not required to provide contraceptives, with Justices Alito, Roberts, Thomas, Scalia, and Kennedy being the majority, and Justices Ginsburg, Kagan, Sotomayor, and Breyer being in the minority. So that's basically what happened with the case and how they ruled, and they did win, which is an interesting development regarding corporations and whether or not they're people. So there is obviously a lot of controversy regarding the case, the decision of the case, and just the basic fundamental laws that spurred on this case. So the opposition says that Hobby Lobby can't just ignore written laws because of their morals, given that they are a for-profit craft store, which does not exempt them according to the rules and guidelines within the ACA, which says nonprofits who object to this to contraceptives and religious based, I guess, stores or places like churches or association of churches. This might the decision of this case might cause other corporations to object to providing contraceptives because of their moral and religious beliefs, which are in quotations because they could possibly lie about this just to not pay for something. They also say that these specific types of contraceptives are not akin to abortion. But it all depends on your view on when a fetus becomes a baby, I guess. And the final thing is, for-profit organizations and businesses should not be allowed to enforce their religious beliefs on their employees, because that could really impact their lives. That could really cause a detriment to their lives. And supporters of the ruling say that Hobby Lobby, prior to dropping the health care due to the lawsuit, provided 16 of the 20 contraceptives, which is pretty good. In addition, they did not prevent women from taking them. They just said they didn't want to pay for it. The First Amendment is also not only in regards to people, it also applies to corporations and companies, which would, of course, include Hobby Lobby. Many also say that being a person of faith is not something that's just a small part of your life. It's everything. It's not just your personal life, it's your business and your work. And so they say that if you're going to be religious, it's religious everywhere. So that's basically our presentation of Hobby Lobby v. Burwell. Thank you for listening, and goodbye.